Hey everybody, welcome back to Real Videos. Your man T-Bone here, hanging out with my boys.
Falling up on the never going back to OK Tour. How's it going, guys?
Oh, it's going great.
Thank you.
If an alien was looking for test subjects, which member of your band would you offer first?
This is what I like to call the shows. I like you guys. Introduce yourself to the people that are out there watching. So just tell them what your name is.
And what you're doing. Hey guys, how are you?
I'm Jerry.
We started out when we were in high school, just wee little lads in Albany, Oregon. I was only 16 when we started playing in our parents' garages and making really, really terrible music. And then after we graduated high school, we got signed to Tooth & Nail Records, which is based out of Seattle, Washington. And from there, we just went on tour and made a bunch of records and grew up together, basically. And so as friends and musicians and bandmates, we spent the last, essentially it's been the last 10 years of our lives just working really hard, playing music, and trying to grow with maturity and with our, you know, just friendship and music. But in the summer of, I believe it was 2002, we made a demo with a local producer, and then a couple of our friends who were in the band Cutlass, who were signed to Tooth & Nail at the time, had the CD. They took it, actually, the next day that we recorded it. It hadn't even went to mastering yet, and they took it up to Seattle because they were having like a meeting or something up there, and they just kind of passed it along to the president of the record label, Tooth & Nail, and he called me. It was weird. He called me on the phone the next day, which was very strange because I was, you know, just 18 years old, and this record label president from a record label that isn't like massive, but from the local scene and growing up, like there were bands that we looked up to a lot on that label. So I was like freaking out when the president called me up and was interested in having a meeting with us. So from there, we had a meeting with the president and eventually got signed. And then 2 years, or no, it was just a year and a half later, we made our first album, which was Crashings. Always you are with me. A lot of those songs on Crashings were songs that I wrote when I was 16, and we recorded it when we were 19. So it was like we spent a lot of time practicing those songs and that record, because we wanted to use a lot of these songs that we were playing locally and stuff, and kind of made or gave us our name up to that point as far as locally. Like we wanted to put those songs on the CD. So that CD to me is a little bit young sounding. I mean, we were young compared to now, but also just because the songs were even outdated, I felt, at the time, being that I wrote them when I was 16. So that record was definitely a learning experience. I mean, we learned a lot about being, you know, in the studio and being with a producer, and then from there we just we went out on tour and hit the road, and we were very eager to kind of get out of town. And and, you know, none of us went to college or had hopes of going to college. And so once we got signed, we were like, all right, this is our full-time job. This is our full-time gig. And so we toured that first year after we recorded Crashings. We toured pretty much straight through the full year. a year later, we recorded Dawn Escapes, our sophomore record. We recorded that in Virginia with a producer named Elvis Basquette. And that was a really cool experience. It was at this beach house in Virginia Beach. And it was a really, really neat time. And that one, that record in particular, was kind of the moment with our band where we, I felt, were like really united with a group of people that we had at the time. We were all really close, and we were all making music that we felt was our best. And at that point, it kind of gave myself a chance as being a writer to grow from being the last time that I really wrote was when I was 16, and then, you know, giving the chance to really write that I felt was a little bit more updated versions of what our style was. So Dawn Escapes came out in, I think it was 2005, or 2006. I think it was 2005, in the fall of 2005, and then we just kept touring, and basically we toured straight on through. After that record came out was our longest stint of touring. We toured for about 2.5 years just straight. Again, like where we would come home for just a couple days here and there, and for Christmas. We decided to make a remix record, and that record was originally, the idea was I was just going to get on my laptop and just put some loops together and make some synth stuff and just pull some of the files off of our old songs and make a remix record. When I kind of introduced the idea to the band and to our manager at the time, we thought we should make it a little bit more of an affair, and we hired a couple producers, and I wrote a couple songs just for the occasion, and we recorded those, and then we did that remix. That was a really fun project, but at the time, we were all in Nashville, because that's where our manager was from, and it was during the winter, right after Christmas, and we were on a break from touring, but we were just there, and a lot of us didn't really have friends there, and no family, so it was kind of tough being there, and I felt like that record it was a little harder to be in the studio, because I didn't really feel like I was in the element of really doing a record with my friends and you know, playing some cool music. But we got through it, and I felt like we made the best of it, and so it was a fun experience. But then we went on tour from there, and toured again for another couple years. When we started to record Captiva, it was just at a point in our careers where, you know, we were with a label, and they were expecting us to make a pretty radio record, but, you know, we wanted to, our disagreements with them was that, you know, we were growing as musicians and as people, and we really wanted to make an album that was semi-radio, but also semi for us, and showed our growth and our maturity. You know, the economy at the time was starting to slip just a little bit, to where we kind of sat down and had a meeting and thought, all right, you know, if we kind of want to keep our jobs as far as just keeping this thing going and motivated, you know, maybe we should listen to the label. Maybe they do know that, you know, if we do write a radio record, that's what will kind of, you know, keep us going and stuff, and then maybe after that we can do a record that we want to do. So we went into the studio, and we made the best record that we could. There was definitely some problems involving, you know, members leaving and disagreements with the producer at the time, and although it was a lot of disagreements, still that tension with the label was coming back in when we were in the middle of recording. And that's kind of the worst time when you're recording, to have the label and your managers like breathing down your neck and making sure that you're writing a specific way, because, you know, writing music is writing music, and it's not a specific form. And you know, I was definitely feeling the pressure, and we were tired. We were in the middle of touring, and we were back at home recording, and so it was just it was just a trying time for us. But eventually the record came out, we toured it, and it was decent. It for me, it wasn't my favorite record, and for a lot of the guys in the band, it wasn't their favorite record, just because of a lot of the drama involved with things that were going on. And also, just because we felt like we did compromise a little bit on some of the songs, and we gave in to the label just a little bit more than we should have. That began to kind of wear on me, and I started to ask myself, at the time I was about 24, and I started to think, you know, I really want to do something that I want to do. Fangs was definitely a band record. It was for us, because we thought, you know, we had kind of quit because of Captiva and because we were stressed out with that, and we felt like we compromised musically with that record. Fangs was a concept record. It was a story that I wrote, and the music was very experimental. I tried for the most part to make it kind of radio in some degree, but it really wasn't at all. Any songs that could have been radio was kind of just delusion on my part, because I was just like, yeah, I think these could be, but I knew in the back of my mind that they really were songs that were more experimental and more for us. We had a lot of fun doing that record, and we didn't really tour from it, because at being on a break from tour, we kind of all split a little bit. Jeremy moved to Seattle at the time, and we were all kind of involved in different things in our lives, and so touring was a little bit harder. So Fangs just kind of came out, and even though it was my favorite record, it was not really a big popular record with our fans, just because we had changed so much musically. And you know, at the time we recorded it, I was 25 or 26, you know, most of our fans that had followed us from the beginning followed us when we were 18 years old, so it was definitely a big change for them. This last November, I got a call from the label, because they were interested in possibly doing another album, and technically we still had two records left on contract. We kind of threw some emails back and forth with each other, and they were wondering if it was going to be like Fangs, and I said, you know, if I write some new music, it's not going to go back in style, but I'll definitely make it radio. And I think that they might have had a meeting after that point, and thought that probably isn't a wise decision on their part to give us a budget, knowing that I could easily go and make another record like Fangs, and it's experimental and it's not radio or anything. And by now, the economy was completely done, and the record label was really suffering and is still really suffering. And so, you know, they needed bands to write radio singles, and they just, I don't think, trusted that we would. So after a few emails and meetings, they said, you know, we don't really want you to be a part of the label anymore, and we'll let you go. Since we were 18 years old, we were signed to a contract, and we kind of had to do what they said. But now we, you know, we're completely on our own. So the question came up is, should we do a record on our own? You know, we'd have to have a budget to record, and this will have to be a completely independent release. And so that turned into, you know, raising the money ourselves on Kickstarter, which is just a site for a website designed for independent business owners and stuff and entrepreneurs to gain investors and budgets for their projects. So we did that. We raised a fairly good amount of money for our record that we just got done recording, and it's definitely kind of, in my opinion, it's a triumphant story for us, because I really feel that we did write songs that some of them are radio, and some of them are for us and are, you know, musical songs that still show our maturity, and yet at the same time I feel is marketable. And I think that it is something that the label will want, or I mean they won't have it now, but I think that once they hear it, they will. I mean, my hopes is that they'll think that this would have been something that they would have liked to have. The new album, which is called Your Sparkling Death Cometh, is going to be released June 28th. It's a record where I feel is like it does have definitive rock in it, that is mirrored from Dawn Escapes, just in the mentality of it and the nature of it. And then there are kind of softer, more Captiva-driven songs on it towards the last half. So there's definitely a good mix of rock and experimental rock, and then some pop stuff on it. And I think that it's kind of a good blend of styles that we've been working through in the last 10 years, from the very beginning till Fangs. It was like the musical progression, and I feel like this record was a blend of everything. The lyrics that are in this album definitely speak to people on more of an emotional level, and I really feel that people will connect to them, because I wrote this song, or the songs, about certain subjects that I felt strongly about or that was going on in my life. And I think that regardless of the angle that you're looking at it, we all pretty much go through the same things. Love, loss, you know, hope and fear, and all those things wrap into life, and whatever, you know, whatever connotation they're in, I feel like, you know, if you speak about the subject, people can connect to it. And so this record does have that stuff in it, and I'd say overall this record is about hope, and it's about just focusing solely on love versus focusing on just the gimmicks of life and the distractions in life that distract us from hope and from love. This record I really feel will connect with people on a level that was different from Fangs, and that I feel we had back in the day with Falling Up. And so I'm really excited about this new album, because it's kind of a new chapter for Falling Up, but also kind of circling back, like I said earlier, upon itself. And I feel lyrically and musically it's kind of doing the same thing without reverting to old style or just something that is outdated. So Your Sparkling Death Cometh is definitely kind of, I feel, a monumental thing just in our lives. It's probably not that big of a deal to anybody else, other than maybe fans who have been around for a while or people who are just interested in what we've been doing. But I feel it's monumental to us because of the things that we went through and where we are now. So, yeah, I'm really excited about it.